Right, you heard lots of people say lots of things. And now all of you have an opportunity to ask a question. So who's going to start? Yeah, and you've got to tell me your name.
Sure, yeah.
And so, how old you are, sorry.
Okay. So my name's Jess, I'm 21, I just finished my third year at Northeastern. And I just wanted to know, since we are studying how gender is impacting development, how you would say, for both of you really, how your role is impacted by your gender, I guess.
I have a love affair with women in pretty much everywhere, and definitely in the developing world. I mean that in the best possible sense. I think women are extraordinary and strong and reliable and creative and entrepreneurial, and generally will go to every extreme to provide for and protect the people they love. So I think they're an awesome investment. And I think you're looking at an unprecedented time when we finally have data that says that if there were gender parity today, we would add $23 trillion to the global economy, and that is the entire GDP of the United States and China put together. So we should not be having any more gender conferences, and we should just have 50-50 everywhere. Yeah. That's all I have to say on gender.
Well, I'm a typical Indian male. But I have a formidable wife. Always keeps me on track whenever I go out a bit here and there. And her name is Aruna Roy. You can see her on...
Yeah, I've given her name and talked about it. MKSS.
Right, okay. So, whenever I say something which is not correct, I'm always brought down to earth. And that's been happening for the last 44 years. So I think we are very gender sensitive in this organization. Highly gender sensitive. And we make sure that everything that is, every service that we provide in a village anywhere through the Barefoot College, we make sure that the women are always involved in some capacity. And they always don't feel that they're marginalized, they don't feel they are victimized. And I think Thelonia has developed a reputation in this area around that we are over gender sensitive about these things, I think.
I don't think there's any such thing, really.
She's got a Western view. Talking about an Indian view. Anyway, it works. It's very important that these views are aired in public. And I think we are very... The fact that, I think, have they seen the work on
yeah.
the other side?
Yeah.
All right. The fact that we are only concentrating on bringing technology to very marginalized women from all over India is a demonstration that we're very serious about this.
I think sort of an interesting example is that, so you've understood a bit about caste and about how that works. Yeah, no, because you've been in India for a while. So in what year did you first train the hand pump mechanic?
83.
So 1983. And we're talking, this part of India is arguably one of the least gender equal parts of India. The North is traditionally much more, has much more gender issue than the South. And in Thelonia, they were training women Dalit hand pump mechanics in 1983 to be the source of water for desert Rajput communities. Now, that is like taking the lowest possible person on the pecking order and putting them in control of the most precious resource that absolutely everybody at the top wanted and needs access to and needs for life, work, and everything else. So I don't think they talked about gender in a confrontational way at that time, but it got the job done. So I think that was I love to tell that because I think it very much exemplifies Bunker's approach to, and the team's approach to designing for gender equality as opposed to just trying to beat it into people's head and talk about it. I don't think it gets done that way. The night schools too, which you saw last night, which are predominantly girls, and that's a total social justice environment. You know, most of those kids would not be sat next to in a state school, They wouldn't be spoken to. They wouldn't be played with. Teachers would bully them. So, you know, there's much more going on there under the surface.
My question was regarding the civil society development that you emphasized. I'm really curious, my frame is mostly just kind of the collective consciousness of societies and of groups of people. And I'm curious, what's the most effective way that you guys have found in shifting those kind of paradigms for how people view gender and how they view equality?
Civil society in India is not well understood even now after 60 years since independence. Because they don't see the legitimacy of a civil society, because the government says, but who are you? I mean, where did you get your mandate from? So there's always these questions which are in the air all the time. When they want to get at civil society, they always ask these questions. But for the first time in 1984, we got a chapter. At that time, there used to be something called the five-year plan of the government of India. That is the five-year plan of the government moving forward. And in the seventh five-year plan, someone said, what is the approach of the seventh plan? And one very eminent economist said, it's the seventh approach to the same plan, which happened in 1952. That was the first plan, and we've never changed since then. But in the seventh plan document, when the Prime Minister at that time was Mr. Rajiv Gandhi, he insisted that there be a document, a policy document on civil society included, because they never ever saw the need to recognize the work that civil society had done for so many years, the Gandhian organization, the Sarvodaya organizations, all of them had a great rich history, tradition of volunteerism. So at that time, the Prime Minister said, you must have a document in the Government of India document saying what the role of the voluntary sector would be, the civil society sector would be. And with great political pressure, he managed to include that chapter on civil society. And in that chapter, we also demanded that some government money be put into civil society. And at that time, the government said, but you guys are outside government. You have no right to government money. I said, but government money is public money. I also pay my taxes. So I have every right to see how the government money is used properly. So we asked and demanded that we have a little bit of the government budget put into civil society. And that was accepted. That was a revolutionary step made on the seventh plan. And from then on, civil society has been a part of a development wing of the government. Now, unfortunately, civil society, because of the work they're doing, sensitive work, working with Dalits, working with untouchables, working on human rights, working on all these sensitive issues, it got politicized. And we kept saying that, look, we are not anti-government, we are anti-establishment. Please don't mix the two. But people couldn't make out the difference between us being anti-establishment and being anti-government. And especially the lower rungs of the bureaucracy kept on saying, but you're doing political work. I said, we're not doing political work, we're doing development work, which has political implications. But we're not doing party political work. So from then on, civil society has been much in the news these days, because this present government has gone after some very prominent civil society organizations. For good reason or bad, some of them made it into the news because they hadn't filled up the forms properly, they hadn't declared the documents they should have given to the government properly. All these things became a big mess, but civil society right now is under threat because they do not understand the role of civil society. Fortunately, this organization, because it's had, oh my God, you must be one of the very few first organizations to start in 1971. and most of the youngsters like you were, who came to the organization at that time, are now very senior government officials. They are permanent secretaries, they are permanent ambassadors, so they all know that Thelonia, or at least the Barefoot College, is not engaged in political activity. They've been a part of this organization for many years. So they have defended us wherever they could with the political powers that be. That this organization is apolitical, but they are doing political work of sorts, because if you're working with very poor people, you will be doing political work whether you like it or not. So there's always that big debate, eternal debate, endless debate on who you are, what your legitimacy is, all these things will go on, and there's never a conclusion on this. So I don't know if I've answered your question, but...
No, but Bunker, I think also he'd like to know a little bit about your approach to sort of mobilizing within communities. You know, sort of how you look, because you're really great in community when you're talking with people, and how you approach communities.
If you approach a village and everyone is for your project, there is something wrong. Someone must get hurt. Someone must object. Someone must not say this is the right thing to do. Because someone's vested interests should be affected. And if we are affecting the vested interests of moneylenders, of corrupt government officials, of elected bodies, then we are on the right track. Okay? How do we manage to do that? We say that this service that the Barefoot College is providing will be only for the poorest of the poor. If it's a question of locating a hand pump, we will locate it in the poorest of the poor area of the village without going through the political hierarchy. So everyone is upset. Why haven't you consulted us? Why haven't you called us? We are the elected members. We should be consulted. We say, I'm sorry. We know the area as much as you do. Just incidentally, you happen to be elected, but we know the poor people of the area. And we would like to put the hand pump or the night school right there in the middle of this very poor part of the village. Now, what are you going to do about that? So they said, no, I mean, you know, you're not following protocol. I said, yeah, I know I'm not following protocol. Too bad. Now, tell me what I'm doing wrong. You also want us to go to the poorest part, yes? You got elected by the very poor people. So we are actually providing this service to the very poor people. What we're doing against what you already professed you said you would do. But they said, you should get our stamp to go to that village. I said, we don't need any stamp. I'm sorry. So all development comes out of conflict. Conflict of change, conflict of methods, conflict of approaches, conflict of lifestyles, all this. There has to be an element of conflict in every change that you bring about. Just remember, there's never a final solution, because with every solution, you're creating a new set of problems. Okay? So there's never a final solution. If I put in a hand pump in the poorest of the poor village, there's bound to be repercussions, there's bound to be discussions, there's bound to be dialogue, there's bound to be hostility. You have to factor in that when you take that act. But that, if you have the staying power, if the organization has the staying power to do that, go for it. If you don't have the staying power, you're not confident, don't go for it. Don't go into that area, because you're going to lose. And they've sized you up, we have sized you up. Let's see who wins, who blinks first. So this is all a big game. Right?
No, I think it's something that I've been talking a lot with the young people around the campus about. Because all of the fellows, in one way or another, have come up against resistance. And the Western world has evolved in a way in which we've all been conditioned into being so politically correct. And we've all been conditioned into finding the the solution that everybody will agree on. You know, this is our idea of success, is somehow based around finding coalition and everybody's happy at the end and everybody's okay. And it's really hard to unlearn that and to realize that you are never going to have that if you're doing the right thing, probably. You're going to put yourself in a conflictual situation, and it's all going to be how you handle and channel that conflict into either good or bad ways and your ability to manage it as opposed to it managing you. And that's something I think that's a hard skill to learn, but an essential one.
Someone raised their hand. Sorry.
So I was wondering what the training process is for those women, and you mentioned in your talk that you target illiterate women specifically, so mm-hmm. I was wondering why that is, and if there is excitement, like if you find that they're eager, or how, like, what is the feeling like when they're coming, you know, like, are they...
They're terrified.
Terrified? Like,
they're
how
terrified.
Do you get the participation? You know, like, why do they want to come and participate?
Okay, well, lots of
Sorry,
questions
that was,
there.
Like,
no, no, lots of questions there. Okay, I'll try to be brief. We use the community mechanism to encourage them to come. So in the course of that long discussion about what they're spending on their lighting options and, you know, what other challenges the community's facing, and we start nailing down how much is a reasonable monthly contribution. There are women within, so we've got the whole village there. That has to be a total democratic situation with everybody there, young, old, men, women. You say, how much are you spending on kerosene? The men say this much. The women go, no, we're not. We spend this much. Women really tend to know what they're spending. And the men lie about it because they've probably spent a third of what they earn on, you know, alcohol or other women or, you know, whatever they spend it on. And women really like count the pennies to spend it on the family and what's going on there. And so they really know and keep track. So we try to look for women who really present themselves as having, you know, a really sure voice in those conversations. Lots of times we'll see women kind of move to the front of the group through the course of that conversation. Sometimes they're midwives, traditional midwives, or have some other role of responsibility in the community, so they're kind of natural leaders. And we generally, in the course of like a two-hour meeting, we almost always have the same, like we're like, it's that one and that one, right? And we just do that by instinct now. Because you can see if a woman's gonna, because we know she's in for a rough thing. But they volunteer not knowing anything about where they're going and what they're really gonna do. You know, they volunteer because they sense there's an opportunity here to participate in doing something that will change things for everybody they love and care about. And that's enough to get them to put their hand up and say, okay, I wanna go. And if we have resistance from men, we deal with that by invoking the community thing. Well, if the community wants light, you'll have to send a woman, because Government of India, this is only a program for women. You know, we use everything we can, a little larceny, a few, you know, stories. We use everything we can to get them to come. They're terrified, they come. The training was designed by illiterate and semi-literate trainers and by a solar section that's led by an exceptional man who had a really sensitive vision for the learning process. Almost all of the section heads here have been night school teachers. So at base, they are teachers. And so whatever else they do is always about and grounded in this view, this lens of teaching it on. And so Bhagwat Nandan designed with his team a color-coded, color-banded system and a circuit board that allows the women to build looking at the numbers and the colors in sequential order. And so that's how they troubleshoot, because they actually learn by rote in their head, not by writing down, the values of each of the resistors and capacitors, how they have to be installed in life. So you've got exactly what we talked about earlier. You have this knowledge sharing between same community. You know, why should a literate person design a program for an illiterate user? Why isn't it better to have an illiterate, semi-literate person designing for other semi-literate people? And so that is now been published in a book, and it's now an online, it's now a digital manual. And the women are learning in a three-dimensional sense. So they don't know theory, like they don't learn the progression in a Western education would be you'd learn the theory and then you'd learn the technical aspects of it. They don't learn it like that. They learn to do it, and then as they're doing it and the light goes on, they then realize, oh, okay, the sun comes in there and it goes through here and now the light comes on. So they learn in the complete reverse order with the technology first and then the practical applications. And then from there, their mind starts going pretty quickly. And then they start to think they know a whole lot of things about other things too, and that's sort of funny, and they do generally somehow. So yeah, it's fascinating. And the thing that we see in all of the women is that the competence and confidence that comes from mastering a piece of technology is irreplaceable, irreplaceable. I was watching yesterday a woman, a Liberian mama, and she was, so Lisa, she says to Lisa, now Lisa, the woman who was here yesterday is the VP of, now it's on the internet so I can say that, she's the vice president of sustainability for all of Apple. She was the director of the Environmental Protection Agency under two presidents. She was Obama's director of the EPA before she was hired by Apple. And she walked into the room and this Liberian woman goes, "And who are you? What's your name?" And she said, "My name's Lisa." And she sat down and she started chatting to her. And this woman said, "You see what I'm building here? I've got this circuit board. And number 507 is this capacitor." She went through about 25 things of these. And she's like, and she said, "I'm going back to be a solar engineer and we're building a training center." I mean, she so knows what's going on. It was unbelievable. And I hope somebody filmed it, because it was just the most amazing like thing to have this illiterate mama from Liberia lecturing the head of Apple sustainability about what she'd learned, how she'd learned it, and what she was going to do with it. It was just fantastic. So that's what you get at the end of that.
My name's Claire. I'm 19, and I was just wondering how you've been able to adapt to so many different like communities and cultures across the globe, and like what impact that's had on how your program works overall.
She's doing very well. Carry on.
No, I talked enough. You're bored with me.
No, come on.
We have bunker. That's the answer to that question. I think that what Bunker understood about this particular initiative, about the solar initiative, I think very early on, was the universal nature of what they were doing and how there were not, the challenges that were facing all these communities were absolutely the same. His understanding of, which I had absolutely no idea about before I started working here, his understanding of the mechanisms in communities that drive them to do certain things and behave certain ways and react certain ways to things was essential to being able to do that, 100%. I don't think somebody who didn't have that deep community understanding of the elements at play in communities could have ever taken this model to so many different divergent communities. Now we're at a different place. You know, now we're at a little different place because now we're able to articulate. In the beginning, it was wholly instinctual. And now, of course, he's got, you know, us morons from the white Western world who write it up, you know, and we've packaged it up in a way that people hopefully can understand and implement on their own so it can grow. But there's no replacement.
When I was your age, I was in the university, and the Vietnam War was on, 65. And at that time, there was a story, which I still remember, of someone asking Chairman Mao in China, "Chairman, why don't we have a war with America?" So the chairman said, "Why? You know, we have a housing problem, we have poverty problems, we have all sorts of problems. We have a war with America, then they'll feel sorry, and they'll come back with aid, and China will be great." So the chairman thought for a minute and said, "Comrade, what happens if we win? Everything that comes from the West, we feel is superior. But we don't think of what we have among us inside, which is so powerful. We don't recognize it. And the Barefoot College is an attempt to make people recognize that they have the power within them to solve their own problems. We don't need anybody from outside. If you start with that premise, then everything is simple. What has the World Bank or the UN got that we don't have already? I keep asking people that. What have you got that we don't have already? Tell me, other than money, which also is sometimes important, what have you got? Are you going to tell us about how to work with communities? No. Are you going to tell us that these people haven't got the skills? I don't need a report for that. Are you going to tell us what is required in a village? I don't need a $100,000 report for that. So what have you got? What have you got to tell us? Or what have you got to give us that we don't have already? So we don't allow any World Bank people to come into this organization. We don't allow most of the UN people to come. Because all these consultants come for a $1,000 day consultancy, telling us about community participation, which is ridiculous, you know what I mean. So we think that there is enough, you know, when there was no doctor, no teacher, no engineer 100 years ago, what did communities do? They came, they solved their own problems, they identified their own problems and came up with solutions. Barefoot College thinks that those solutions need to be revived, need to be brought into mainstream, need to be shown that those solutions are still applicable and still relevant today. Not doing anything original. People have done it for hundreds of years. We're just saying, have a look at these solutions, which have stood the test of time. And don't devalue it, don't look down on it, because it is all based on common sense. Not someone who's done double PhD somewhere, someone who just looks around and sees. You know, Mark Twain said, never let school interfere with your education. Education is what you get from your family, from your community, from your environment. Never look down on that. So we feel that the Barefoot College has a very global message, which we learn from Gandhi, we learn from the community, we learn from people who are very poor. Commonsensical solutions which need to be brought in, even if all the so-called experts look down on it, we think there's great value in it. I'll give you a small example. If you go to an engineer and you ask, how do we solve the drinking water problems of the area, they'll say, put in a hand pump.
Think a well.
Open well, hand pump, just take the water out of the ground. If you go to the old man in the village and say, what should we do about water? They'll say, just collect rainwater. We've been doing it for thousands of years. What's wrong with that? The whole thing got mucked up just because we had this hotshot engineer coming to take the water out of the ground. So in 1980, we stopped drilling hand pumps. Because every year we see the hand pumps going dry. Why? Because more water is being taken out of the ground than what is going in. So now we have a massive program on, because we listened to the old man in the village and said, let's collect rainwater on a war footing. Wherever the rain falls, collect. But if you ask the engineer, why aren't you doing rainwater? And you know what his stupid answer is? He said, it wasn't in my curriculum. You know? Just because it wasn't in his curriculum, he couldn't use common sense. Big problem we have with the formal education system today. They are not using common sense.
There's also, while I'm really hopeful, because I've certainly seen in the last 5-6 years many more institutions understanding and resonating with community-led development at scale and decentralized models at scale. I'm pretty optimistic that there are lots of people now getting that, and it is actually starting to have some traction. But the money is still not following. You know, the real money investment that needs to be, you know, funneled to those kinds of solutions is still not happening. Because it's still somehow, it's back to your question about the value proposition. There is still the idea that somehow a solution where somebody makes money is a more responsible solution. Or a solution that costs a lot is a more responsible solution. How can something great not be the most expensive thing on the shelf? You know, this is the big mindset shift. This is the mindset shift, is to not equate effective and sustainable with expensive. And that's still not there yet.
Another question.
Yeah.
Hello, my name is Vivian, and I'm from Ecuador. And I'm 21. I'm from Ecuador, and I'm 21 years old. My question, we have been in India for...
I kept on asking age because I started barefoot at 24. So I wanted to know how old you are. Sorry.
My question is, we have been in India for around 2 weeks, and we have visited amazing organizations. And I think that we all, or at least I'm thinking of, how can I make a change? How can I go back to Ecuador and start something? You said that you started when you were around 24 years old. So if you could talk with yourself when you were 21, what would you recommend to yourself or to us?
At 21, I was the greatest sportsman on earth. I was the Indian national squash champion for 3 years, and all the jobs were lying at my feet. And at 21, I went to a village for the first time in Bihar. There was a famine. I'd never seen my country, because I came from a very exclusive educational background, which didn't allow us to go into a village. You know, we were protected. What happened in the village was something else from what happens in Delhi and Bombay and New York. And we were all being prepared for that, because the education system that I went through were preparing me to be a banker or a diplomat or a teacher or a doctor. That was all. So out of curiosity, I went to a village for the first time. And I saw my own country for the first time, and I had never seen it before at 21. It's a big shock. Very big shock. And at 24, I said, I would like to just be an unskilled laborer digging wells. So I dug wells for 5 years, unskilled. I just went into a well, and I put explosives, and I came out, and for 5 years, I was doing just that. And that was when I found that these very ordinary people were so extraordinary. Such skills they had, we hadn't even heard of. Not even recognized, not respected. And I thought I would start something which would bring them that recognition they deserved. I had no project, I had no money. And when someone asked me, what should I do at this age? I'll say, you get onto the first train, go 50 kilometers, get off at the first station after 50 kilometers, and live there for 6 months without offering anything. See whether you can do it. See whether you have the staying power to be able to manage. You can go to whatever university or college in the world you want to go to, but that will not test you the way you are in a village with nothing. Can you live like very ordinary people? Can you live and survive? And just say, look, I've got nothing. I just want to stay and live with you and see how you work and how you live and how you... It's a very big shock. It actually gives you enough to find out for yourself whether you have it in you or not. And if you don't have it in you, don't feel sorry. You gave it the best shot you had, and it didn't work out. So what? But without giving it a shot, you'll always regret something that you never did.
Thank you.